بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين سيدنا ونبينا محمد بن عبد الله الصادق الأمين. أحمدك ربي على كل قضائك وجميع قدرك، حمد الرضا بحكمك لليقين بحكمتك، وأصلي وأسلم على خير خلقك ونور عرشك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر، صدق الله العظيم. Brothers and sisters in Islam, respective viewers, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and ahlan wa sahlan. Welcome to our weekly program, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may Allah tabarak wa ta'ala grant all the marhumin jannatul firdaus. Allahumma ghafir lahum warhamhum wa sakkinhum fil jannah. Rabbi irhamhuma kama rabbayana saghira. And we ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, may Allah rabbul izzah tabarak wa ta'ala make it easy for those who are in difficulties, those who experience some hardship. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala write all their difficulties as a hasanat in their life inshallah, and in their scale in the day of qiyamah. Once again, we thank you that you're always tuning to our program, and we welcome all our new viewers, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us to pass the message of Allah and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Once again, we thank you, and we thank all our viewers in South Africa and out of South Africa inshallah. They say, ma'ad Allahu fahuwa batilun. Anything besides Allah, it's useless. Anything you don't mean Allah on it, it's a waste. The question of today, how many minutes and hours and years we did waste in our life. The time and the era, your age, your life, it's you. Investment, farming, getting hasanat. Time is money and time is reward. Brother and sister in Islam, my question today, and with that thing which we're going to discuss, why we're wasting time and why we made every action of our life is away from Allah and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We give Allah as ibadah, 5 times salah, but we think the out of the 5 times salah, it's for us or it's for dunya. Each and every action of this dunya belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-abdu wa ma malaka li sayyidihi. The slave and what he got belong to his master. Anything you don't mean Allah on it, it is a waste, it is a lahu, it is no reward. Many of our brothers, they worship Allah sometimes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the other time, which they don't worship Allah and they mean Allah, He made them a slave of something which they worship in. So if you leave the ibadah of Allah, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِ وَنُسُكِ وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Each and every aspect of my life, each and every action of my life, I mean Allah. And it's belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So mind your action, each and every moment in your life supposed to be ibadah. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have created jinn and ins, mankind, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We find ourselves became no more Abdullah, slave of Allah. Many of us became a slave of dunya, Abdul Dunya. Abdul Dirham wa Dinar, the slave of dinar and currency and money, slave of his wife, slave of his own nafs and own desire, slave of shaitan. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us to come back to be Abdullah, the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We fear Allah sometimes. And once you forgot to fear Allah around the clock, you became the person who fear anything besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you fear Allah, people will fear you. If you do not fear Allah, you will fear people and you will fear the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We spend sometimes for the sake of Allah. If you don't, when we spend many times not for the sake of Allah, if you don't mean Allah in your spending, you will waste and you will spend for the sake of shaitan, for the sake of desire, useless spending, and we waste our money. We humiliate ourselves before Allah, and we lower ourselves in sajda and ruku'ah for the pleasure of Allah. And many times we prostrate to something else besides Allah, and we become humiliated before the creation of Allah, and we lose our dignity and our honor. Brother and sister Islam, Allah is the haqq. Anything besides Allah is not haqq, is not the truth, is not for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why we find so many of confusion, no barakah, no benefit, our dua is not accepted. There is an error between our link between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Definitely there is some error. Many of our brothers, they're asking why our dua is not accepted, why we are not salih, why we can't change. Say, because we don't mean Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our beloved Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam linked us with Allah 24 hours. Each and every action, we mean Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our life, our death is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You went to the fortune teller, you forgot Allah, and you lost the company of Allah. You will have a company of jinn, shayateen, sahir. You will be in batil. That's why we said to brother and sister in Islam, always question yourself, always monitor and watch yourself. Are you the slave of Allah really or not? Are you really Abdullah or not? Why we are saying that? Because many of our brothers, that is really a big mess. They are sinning, but they don't know that they are sinning. Committing something against the law of Allah. قَالُوا إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُصْلِحُونَ. They claim that they are maintaining this life. They are making islah for this life. So the problem is that we do not realize that we are sinning, we're committing a sin. And that is a musiba. That the azab of Allah will come baghta, will come sudden, because he was ghafil. He was heedless, he was unaware. Our life in this dunya, our period here in this time, in this dunya, is full of test and calamity and ibtila and testing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not trust your life. Do not trust yourself. Do not trust your nafs. Brother and sister in Islam, first we have to admit that we are the children of Adam alayhi salam. And kullu ibn Adam khatta, every son of Adam is a sinner. So we have to accept that we are the sinner. But also not enough, we have to agree that we are wrong and we must look for solution. We must look for the answer. You cannot just say, yes, I'm sick, I'm ill. So doctors, there's Allah created cure for sickness. The worst sickness we have is sinning. First, you have to understand that you are a sinner. Number two, you have to know what will happen if you commit a sin. If you die with it like this, there is a big disaster will happen in dunya and akhirah. We have to do some action to prevent ourselves from that type of sickness or that type of sinning. Islam also, subhanallah, healing and curing the sickness before it comes and after. وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. We revealed in Quran what is a cure and mercy to the believer. Shifa, when you have a problem. Mercy that you won't get that problem. Many of our brothers, they never experienced the sin of the other. That is also mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many of the brothers, they commit a sin and they don't do it anymore. So that is shifa. That is medication from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to learn that we must cut all the means which bring us closer to the sin. Asbab, la taqrabu, do not come closer. Try to close all the doors of fitna. And that's why we said sharia. Do not, men and women and the relationship, hijab and this and that, salah and ibadah and fear of Allah. All that we are trying to prevent ourselves from that type of haram, which a disaster in dunya and akhirah. First, we have to understand that we are sinner. What type of sin? You involve on zina, there is medication. You involve on haram, ghaibat, backbiting. Every da, it has dawa. Every sickness and illness, it has a cure and medication. But the problem that we don't want to believe that we are sick, we are sinner, and also we don't want to believe in our doctor. Doctors for physical sickness, they are working very well. And also we trust them too much. But doctors for morality, ulama, anbiya, salihin, those people who give us wisdom, we don't want to trust them and we don't believe on their medicine and medication. Brother and sister in Islam, let us think how to get rid of that type of haram, especially those who enjoy the haram, those who accepted that type of haram. You ask him, why are you doing this? He say, I enjoy. It's my hobby. I can't imagine myself without this type of action. Any type of haram against the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is a big musibah, because that bala man kasaba sayyatan wa ahatat bihi khatiyatu. The one who gained the haram, the one who feels that he's achieving, and the one who gained that haram and haram surrounding him and jailed him and locked him on that. And that's why you find many people, they can't get rid of that haram or that sin. Why? It's already become a slave of him, his nafs, and slave of his haram. Why we're saying that? Because we see 80 years men still on the bad habit. 70 years men can't make salah. Why? Because he set up his mentality. And he's ignorant, he does not know how serious that situation or that case is. Very serious. Number one, he's unfortunate person in the community. Even if he's still receiving the bounty of Allah or the grace of Allah. Because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is getting angry with someone, he will bless him more. The next one, that if he's unfortunate, if he doesn't feel that he's unfortunate, it means he's the enemy of Allah. Fir'aun, for 70 years, he never got sick. He never got sick. He will become victim for anyone, and he will become the enemy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if he died with it, he died musir. What is musir? He's the one who insists to do haram and challenging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those type of people, they need help. They must come and they must sit and understand that they are in a very terrible condition. And may Allah, especially those who are elderly people, those who are old, they are needy to the mercy of Allah and to get the tawbah. When we say tawbah, we say the absolute tawbah. People involved in backbiting and gossiping, those who like to uttering words against the salihin or the Muslim people. Now, we find some sisters and brothers, they enjoy talking about the guilt and the sinning of the others. Not only talking, and they like to hear and listen about the other story, especially story of zina and that immorality of the others. We are sitting, someone come to spend the time with us and start to make that something is called rami and qadhif. Rami, when you're uttering people, qadhif, when you're uttering the innocent people for something they never do it. So and so committing adultery, zina, the wife of that man is doing that stuff with this man or that uncle with this lady. They talk about zina. Zina in Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about it in many places. They call it major sin or al-fahisha. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Inna alladhina yuhibbuna an tashi'a al-fahishatu fil ladhina amanu. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about those who desire, who like to hear about fahisha, zina, and zina must be common, all-knowing amongst the believer. لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ فِي الدُّنْيَا. They will receive a painful punishment in dunya. عذاب أليم. You know, it's very disgraceful, painful, great punishment في الدنيا والآخرة. والله يعلم وأنتم لا تعلمون. They will experience the عذاب in their lifetime and in آخرة. And Allah سبحانه وتعالى is giving us a warning on this ayah. And Allah knows and you do not know. You do not know that you are involved on that, uttering words, accusing people of zina, taking that issue and make it common amongst the Muslim. This ayah is not talking about those who talking only. Those who like to talk or to hear. Because you see, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُحِبُّونَ, they admire, they like to make it issue. It means the thought. You know, we know that our haram happen or written, recorded when we have, when we do the action. But what about those who wish and admire to hear or to talk about fahisha in those who believe, amongst the believer? Spreading fahisha, talking about zina, advertising about zina, it's a sin. We know that the person who commits zina, he will be counted when he start to do it and talk about it. But in our ayah here, in our ayah verse, talking about those who thinking and admiring, those who are longing to know about zina and to hear about zina. Because some people, they don't commit zina, but they like to hear a story about zina. Spreading, لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ فِي الدُّنْيَا. They will have a painful punishment in dunya, and that painful punishment, they will do the same, or one of their family will do the same, and will experience that problem in his home, in his life. وَالْآخِرَةَ, no akhira is the عذاب of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the person who commits zina to keep quiet, and also commanded me and you to keep quiet, not to talk about it, to cover, not only for us. Because when we make that type of haram common, or advertise for it, and like many people say, zina become common amongst the Muslim, many Muslims, no, like that. You know why is dangerous? Why is so serious? Because it's very dangerous for the entire ummah. Number one, you advertise for it, so you encourage the others to do, or you make someone take it easy because he's not alone. So you comfort him and you encourage him and give him a little bit of peace of mind that he's doing it, he's not the only one. You got so many people are doing it. And also, it's very bad because we're supposed to cover and conceal the secret of the other. And also, maybe that person you talk about it, him, he's already in tawbah. He repent and he returned back to Allah. When he returned back to Allah, so he become Habibullah. Now he become a friend of Allah. Waliyullah, inna Allah yuhibbu tawabin. Allah loves those who repent. And now when you talk bad about the beloved one to Allah, you're waging war between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah forgive and we have to forgive. Allah conceal, cover and we have to cover. Brothers and sisters in Islam, it is a very serious issue regarding those who keep themselves busy with batil. He left his salah, he left his amal and wajib, and he's talking about this lady or this man. Allah said in this ayah, وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah knows how serious is this one and you do not know. Allah realize it and you do not realize it. Allah is aware about it and you're not aware about it. It means a very fearful ayah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we said, we try to encourage one another to look good. Amongst the Muslim, we have to look good. Amongst the non-Muslim, we have to look also very good to encourage the other to join Islam and to show the beauty of Deen in Islam. If you talk bad about a Muslim, if you try to publish and expand that news, you are the enemy of Allah and you are the waging war between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why we said to the brother and sister in Islam, be careful, evil of the tongue, watch out, because once you talk about it, you will be one of this issue one day. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for you and I to save our tongue from any bad words against the Muslim, especially zina. When we talk about sinning and the haram, and why the Muslim ummah they have that type of sickness which is called backbiting and gossiping. We know that riba got 72 types. The minimum type or the smallest type of that riba is like you commit adultery with your own mother. Backbiting, it's worse than riba. All the 72 type of riba. Many of our brothers and sisters, they are very salih, reading salah, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they have that problem. Why are we saying like that? Because we talk to them and say, why you can't control yourself? Why you don't want to leave it? Is it an issue in the hand of Allah? He said, I don't know, it's my habit. I enjoy, I'm killing time. You say, no, we clever, we don't waste our money. We don't waste our property, we don't waste our health. So why is it so easy for us to waste our reward and our hasanat and our jannat? Because the muflis, the bankrupted one, the one who lost his reward. He will come with salah and zakat and fasting and so many reward, and then in the day of qiyamah he will become empty hand. To ask Allah, where is my reward? Where is my work? He say, akalathu al-ghaybah. Being perished by gossiping and backbiting. It's very dangerous. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from that type of evil and that type of haram. We ask that person, what are you doing? He say, I'm just enjoying, or my spending time, or I'm very jealous of that person. You are favoring him because you're donating all your reward to him. So if you are jealous of that person, you should not give him anything. But once you start to talk about that person, you are favoring him. You're favoring your enemy. Now we advise, come again to the same problem. We advise and come again. That one here, he got some psychological problem. His nafs is overpower him. Now he does not have haqq, so he is busy with batil. Nafs, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. Indeed, is the lucky person or the fortunate person, the successful person, is the one who tried to purify his nafs. Our nafs is our own enemy. That nafs mentioned in the Quran many times, more than 115 times, nafs. That ego, that desire, that creation of Allah, which stick with us till we die. That nafs, a'da'uka, the worst enemy you ever have is your nafs. It's worse than shaitan, because shaitan is very weak. إِنَّ كَيْدَ الشَّيْطَانِ كَانَ ضَعِيفًا. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned the hadith regarding the nafs, and Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, and the Salihin, they always say, the worst fight which we fight in our life is not shaitan and jinn, is not people, is our own nafs. Because nafs corrupted our intention. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. Nafs corrupting our a'mal because of showing off, we do some good deeds for fame and name and all that. So if you make ilaj, you have a full control of your nafs, that's why we call you waliyullah. Why we call that person a friend of Allah, waliyullah? Because he knows how to hold his nafs and control his nafs and that ego and that desire. Quran al-Kareem spoke about that nafs. Now even the psychologists, they say they got a psychological problem. They call it nafsani problem. Oh, that type of complex. That one who hates his father, the one who likes to steal. Now the scientists, they say he's involved in some sickness on his nafs. We as a Muslim, we don't say sickness of the nafs, we say weakness of the nafs. We don't say sickness, because marid, a sick person, excused. That's why we say, no, our main fight, it is our fight against our nafs. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us ability to control our ego and our desire and our nafs. We'll continue with our nafs inshallah next time. Shukran jazeelan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. لا إله إلا الله بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وحده، والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، سيد الأنبياء وخاتم المرسلين، أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ربنا إننا سمعنا مناديا ينادي للإيمان أن آمنوا بربكم فآمنا، ربنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار. صدق الله العظيم. Brothers and sisters in Islam, respected viewers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and ahlan wa sahlan, welcome to our program. First of all, we ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, may Allah tabarak wa ta'ala make it easy for all our brothers and sisters who are sick. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them sabr and shifa and speed recovery inshallah. And we ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant the Muslim peace and security. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala secure our life from the evil of our nafs and shaitan and insan inshallah. Today we're talking about very important issue, which they call it psychological problem. I got some friends when they complain his children, or they complain his boss, or complain his neighbor, they say this one here is psycho. So when we talk about psycho, it means he got complex, he got error in his attitude and his personality. Quran al-Kareem came to heal and to adjust our nafs and our ruh and our body. Many of the ulama, they separated nafs from the ruh, because ruh is min amri rabbi. Ruh is very pure. The soul is very pure. That creation of Allah, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that ruh is min amri rabbi, it's a matter of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That unseen creation in our body. That ruh, it's that power or that energy which cause us to live and to be alive. The body is that creation of Allah, which under our command by permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are slaves under our command. When that body and the soul comes together, this third party appear, it's called nafs, that ego, that desire, or that motivation which drives us to do good or bad. Many people, they say, no, the nafs is the soul, because some ayah talking about the soul and nafs is in the same. But many ulama, they said, no, the nafs encourage us to do good or bad, but the ruh is musabbihatun hamidatun shakira. It's very pious, very pure and clean. That's why it goes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Punishment will never go to the ruh, it go to the nafs and the body. Now when we talk about psychologists and that psychology and that type of science, they know that this nafs is that ego, that desire, that things which drives us to do good or bad. It's very complicated issue because it's unseen creation. They give excuse to everyone that he had a complex. Someone, he does not like to work. He say, I've got psychological problem. I got stress, depression. I got some anxiety. I got psychological complex. They call it in different way. Someone got pride. He said, yeah, he got psychological problem. Someone is very greedy, selfish. They refer that as a sickness. They give tablet, they try. Those who got heterosexuality, that man who involved on alcohol, on women, or all that type of haram, they refer it as complex, or that error on attitude. Yes, it is error on attitude, but not sickness. Otherwise, if anyone makes mistake, we should not blame him at all, because laysa ala al-mareed haraj. There's no burden on a sick person. These people, they try to tell us that there's nothing, it's called haram and halal. this something is called disorder in your personality, and we have to bring it back. We gave them one question. If that is disorder, or you want to excuse that person, why police arrest the criminals? Because also we can count it as a complex. Why deen, all religion, counting a major sin or the sinning or this obey God as a sin? Why we get offended by the action of the others? Deen al-Islam came to tell us about how to control your nafs, how to satisfy your ruh, how to adjust your body so that you can live in peace without no complex, and also you have to go to God with the obedience of Allah and with the law of Allah. If you leave this nafs as is like this to enjoy, this nafs will be out of control and you will see people, they do a horrible crime. So we have a secular law, we have rules in the country, we have regulation, we have certain plan to live on that country, even if that rules different from the other country. So we do have rules in our life, we have law, constitution to adjust that behavior. Even if they allow alcohol, but they say you don't drink here or don't drink while you're driving and all this. So we have to accept that rules and we follow. And if you accept the secular law, why for Sharia law you don't want? You don't want to apply it and you don't want to comply it in your life. And you say, no, I'm excused. If you go to court and you check the sentences and judgment of the judge, you won't find it shouting only or warning only. You find sentence, you find death penalty, you find 6 months, you find 3 years, you find 20 years, you find 2 lifetimes. You find a different cocktail of sentence and punishment. Why? Because we have a different level and type of crime. And the more that sentence become very hard and very serious, the crime will become less. So the more you make that law hard, people get fear. That's why the nafs or that desire, we got fear. We as a Muslim, we try to create inside the nafs the fear, not of the law, the fear of God, which is more beneficial than that law, because that law can't catch me 24 hours. When you see the police, you stop. And if you don't see the police, you do the crime. But we as a Muslim, we have our own law, the Sharia law, which drives me, control my nafs, not to do evil, even if there's no one watch me. So that is more powerful than the other law. Muslims, they don't rob and steal and break houses, not because the police will take them and go to type of judgment, because we were aware about the judgment, the day of judgment. So you'll find that conscience, that fear of God in each and every mind of the Muslimin. People, they don't want to be arrogant. Why? Not because public they will hate us, but also it's a major sin. I will be punished in the day of judgment. So if you don't fear the law, you fear Allah and the day of judgment. Backbiting, all that type of haram we avoid, because we know there is one day and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will judge us and we have to pay for that soon or later. Now yeah, if the police don't catch you or someone doesn't report you, you feel that you're free or you're out of debt. That's why so many criminals, they take advantage because they say police is quiet, police is not there, so they don't worry about the persecution of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On top of that, when we talk about that complex or that type of error in your personality, we Muslim believe that if our nafs also being controlled so much without giving that nafs a halal way to satisfy, you will have a stress, you lose your life, you kill yourself. Why these people commit a suicide? because he could not adjust his nafs with his ruh and his body. He can't survive like this. He doesn't know how to adjust and make that balance between his nafs and his body and his ruh. He can't. So he decided to end his life. We Muslims, we said, no, we don't end our life like that, because I move from one stress to a terrible judgment in a day of Qiyamah, and I will run from small stress to Adabun Aleem and Azeem and Muheen and Jahannam. So now we save our life, not because we love our life, because we're scared of the Hisab and the questioning in the day of judgment. Leave that suicide and that big crime and go for your desire. All of us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us that desire. Desire to enjoy life. So sexual desire is not haram itself. When you misuse it, it becomes haram. You marry 1, 2, 3, 4. So Allah give you many ways, right? Desire of eating. You eat halal. You eat it halal, no problem. Desire of information, you want to know, knowledge, but you misuse it and go for backbiting and gossiping and try to spy some others, that is also not allowed in Islam. So Islam came not to deprive you from your desire, came to adjust your desire so that you can live with no harming and hurting for the others. Rasulullah ﷺ said on a hadith about those people, they call them psychological problem, that وَإِنَّهُ سَيَخْرُجُ مِنْ أُمَّتِي, amongst the Muslims, أَقْوَامٌ, large nation, numbers, تُجَارِي بِهِمْ تِلْكَ الْأَهْوَى, their desire will drive them, كَمَا يُجَارِي الْكَلْبُ صَاحِبِهِ, it will drive them as we, or the owner of the dog, control and drives his dog. You know, you tell your dogs, come like this, or go there, jump here. Your nafs will control you exactly like we control our dogs, our animals, because of food, because of what. Why? Because really we have so many cases that people cannot control their desire. That lady left her halal husband and ran for a boyfriend. Definitely it is nafs. No excuse at all. That person who left his halal income, is working, receiving his halal salary, and ran to cheat and steal and rob and betray and all that. Definitely, he cannot control his nafs. That person who heard adhan for so many times, and he doesn't want to go for salah, can't say, I'm tired, oh, I'm lazy, I'm sleeping, or whatever, it is a nafs. So the main fight in our life, it's a nafs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about nafs. وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. Allah inspired this nafs with two things. Fujur, transgression, and taqwa, piety. Every human being, he got ability to do good or to do bad. So no excuse at all, say, I can't. Muslims, you cannot say, I can't stop zina. Why? Because it's overpower me. I say, no, you're lying. Because we know millions of non-Muslims, they don't commit zina. Someone involved in alcohol, and he said, no, I can't. You say, you're lying, because we got millions of people, children of Adam like you, younger than you, older than you, and they don't drink. We got millions of people who used to do that and they stop. And the Sahaba, 10,000 Sahabi, they were kuffar, idol worshiper for so many years, and decided to leave and they left for the pleasure of Allah. Brother and sister in Islam, no excuse for us to blame our nafs and to blame ourselves and to put it as a disease and sickness and all that. Yes, it is sickness, but you are not excused. You will be charged, you will be questioned about that in the day of Qiyamah. Why we say that? Because we see many brothers, they claim that they can't, but in the month of Ramadan, he can. People who are smoking cigarettes or taking alcohol or involved in bad habit, first day of Ramadan he stops without bayan, without nasiha, without sheikh, without warning, without policing, and he stops. So I can't, we'll wait till the end of the month. So I was asking him to stop for 1 week, he couldn't. And he said, I can't. So that excuse, we say, no, our nafs and bad habit, there's no excuse for it. Because you'd have the willpower and you did stop that immediately on. When you go for Hajj, many people stop smoking. They don't commit anything. They give it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that tazkiyah, that purification, that energy, that taqwa, it's in each and every heart. But who can revive this taqwa and make a decision and say, yes, I have to apply it today. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the month of Ramadan to test our willpower and energy and taqwa. And plenty Muslims, they do it. Anyone who commit a sin in the month of Ramadan, so it means he became a slave of his nafs, not a slave of Allah. That's why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Ameen, Ameen, Ameen. When he was climbing the mimbar, they asked him, what is the first Ameen, Ya Rasulullah? He said, for the one who did witness the life of his parents and he never achieved Jannah. Someone, his mother still alive and father still alive, and he did not please them to please Allah, he is unfortunate person, no hope for him. Another Ameen, for the one who heard the name of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he did not say sallallahu alaihi wasallam or alayhi salatu wasallam. Why? Because once you say sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you're achieving 10 salat from Allah, 10 rahmat from Allah. You say 10, you receive 100. You say 100, you receive 1,000. You say 1,000, you free yourself from the azab of akhirah. So someone was so stingy and so lazy to achieve Jannah by repeating sallallahu alayhi wasallam or make durood or salatu ala nabi. The third Ameen, the one who witnessed the day of Ramadan and he could not achieve Jannah, because really in the month of Ramadan we are utaqa, we are free from the azab al nar and we will enter Jannah. But someone witnessed the month of Ramadan and he could not achieve Jannah, he deserved the azab of Allah. You got so many people who got nafsul kafira. Nafsul kafira, exactly like the nafs of Abu Lahab and Abu Jahl, and nafs of Fir'aun. That ego or that nafs of Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab, imagine a person in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Imagine the charisma of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the nur and attraction and the hidayah and the barakah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in front of you, physically, life, preaching you and guiding you with his kalam, with his smell, with his image, and that person decided to say no and reject the teaching of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We enjoy the kitab about Rasulullah. What about if you have him in front of you, physically in front of you? When we have a salih man, we like to look at him and we get inspired by his words. But imagine your Nabi in front of you. So definitely anyone who received da'wah from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, direct da'wah, physical appearance in front of him, and he rejected that Islam, believe me, brother and sister in Islam, he got nafsul kafira, no hope. No hope for him to enter Jannah at all, because Nabi himself wasn't for. The wife of Nuh alayhi salam, the wife of Lut alayhi salam, they married a Nabi and could not have Hidayah. It means these people got nafsul fajira, kafira, nafsul kafira. We got another nafs, it's called nafsul fajira. This nafsul fajira, someone, he committed sin openly with no fear of Allah. He's a Muslim, no fear of Allah, no fear of the community, no fear of reputation, his family, his wife, his children. That is fajr. Inna al-fujjara lafi jahim. That fajr is this one who commit a sin openly. That's why you said those people who commit a sin openly, so we have to punish them also openly. How is openly? Someone was committing adultery, zina, and he was enjoying his zina till four people come and catch him. Four, not one, two, four. He's such a bold person, fajr, he did not hide himself, he doesn't care. Someone was drinking alcohol till he become drunk and walking on the street and doesn't care about the people. That is nafsul fajra. That's why Sharia was also giving him a very horrible punishment. See, Sheikh, why are you talking about punishment for those who committing heterosexuality or those who got homosexuality? You have to throw them from the high building. It's irregular punishment. It's abnormal. Very funny. And say, yeah, funny punishment for funny action. Why don't you tell him that you're also very funny and you're doing something abnormal, so you have to get abnormal punishment. It's fair, eye to eye, medicine from the same disease and payment from the same giving, as they call it. So that is a nafsul fajira. Hidayah, nasiha, advice, calamity and musiba. He just bury his own father now and he come and commit the same thing. Brother and sister in Islam, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from such nafs like that. After that, we got another type of nafs. It's called nafsul ammara bisu. They call it nafsul ammara bisu. That nafsul ammara, it's so many people got that type of nafs. Doesn't get rest till you commit a sin. Shaitan is not ammar. Shaitan is not ammar. Shaitan is giving mashura and leave you to decide. But this nafs is insisting, determined that you must do such act, only that act, not anything else. He asks Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, how can I know that haram which I commit from shaitan or from my nafs? He said, if you get involved in one type of haram for so long time, is not shaitan, is nafs. Smoking is nafs. Alcohol is nafs. Permanent zina is nafs. Backbiting is nafs. Because shaitan wants you to do any type of haram so that you can be sinner by the end of the day. Your nafs want you to do one thing. That's why they call it complex. He want that man to watch haram. So he said to his nafs, can I go and do? He said, no, you must only watch this one. Can I go and steal and drink? So no, I want that one. So if you find yourself got a bad habit, you don't want to give up, make sure that his nafsi problem, that is a desire, that is an ego, is nothing to do with shaitan. But shaitan wants you to commit this, he says, Sa'udhu Billah, and then you try this, you try that, you try to reduce it, try you to do it in anyhow. That's why we said to brother and sister in Islam, check, examine yourself and see, is your haram because of nafs or because of shaitan? You have to know that. That is called nafsul ammara. Ammara, to ask you again and again, doesn't leave you till you do that. That's called nafsul ammara. Give you energy, willpower to do that type of haram. It's raining, say try. The road is bad, you go. It drives you to do that haram and you no way to go out from that. We got nafs al-lawama, the nafs which blaming us. Many of us, we have this nafs lawama. One word can hurt you a lot and you blame yourself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made qasam and took an oath of that nafsul lawama. Why? Because that person commit a sin and run back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, regret, blame himself, have sorrow, make tawbah, and nadamu tawbah. When you regret and you feel sorry that you commit that, it is a tawbah, that heat and pain on the heart. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appreciated all those who got a nafsul lawama's tawbah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, yes, I place the desire on you. and you did control yourself and you did blame and you returned back to you, to myself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept that from you. So that is nafs al-lawwama. After that, we have a wonderful nafs, nafsul mu'mina, nafsul radiya, nafsul mardiya, and nafsul mutma'inna, and nafsul kamila, which is the nafs of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let us have a control of our nafs. Let us have that ego under the scale of iman. Let's encourage one another to adopt that a pious and salih nafs, which can drives us to do halal and to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We've got so many things to talk about nafs. Unfortunately, our time is up. Inshallah, we'll continue next time. Shukran jazeelan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.